So what are they, so code enforcement came out to enforce something that was not even in the code?
Currently, the codes are that any house built after 2004, you have to have a paved or a, what's it called, an improved surface. Mm-hmm. But mine's a 1954 house.
Okay. So there was, so was there any code that they could enforce that
no.
were...
They made it up. They basically said that, well, we just think you're still a nuisance, so we're going to do that. They came after me for really wacky things, and they still do use code enforcement that way.
Okay. Now, Michelle, mm-hmm. you were involved. You were mm-hmm. there mm-hmm. in a lot of this situation.
Yep.
you must know Kathy very well.
I do.
Is she a balanced professional person?
Very much so. It's been, I think that's the other part of this whole story that people don't see, is I get to see her touching people's lives in her job.
And, so she's able to help
saving
people.
Marriages, helping teenagers get on the right track. We work with a lot of, autistic people. The good that she's doing in her profession is astounding. I'm honored to work for her.
So there's not a question of credibility?
Not by my standard. That was the thing that we really didn't understand, all these attacks, until we saw that Jim Jacks report, and we went, well, no wonder everybody's attacking her, and she doesn't have a voice, because that took away her civil rights and her voice, because everybody said, oh, well, she's crazy, we don't have to listen to her.
She's crazy and she's a liar. That's what they kept thinking.
When you actually have in print that they have written this, and it sounds like using their official authority to for an agenda that basically assassinates your character, it sounds like, I would think that it becomes so obvious, and it has become so bizarre at this point, the natural thing would be for you to defend your rights and say, you can't do this, I have mm-hmm. to stand up for myself, I'm going to sue you for all of these things. Did you do that?
I am doing that. I am suing the city of Vancouver for malicious defamation, but before I did that, I actually wrote to Jim Jacks. I wrote him an email and I mm-hmm. said...
This is while he is a state representative?
A state representative, before he resigned. Yeah, I wrote to him and I said, look, this isn't true. You didn't check it out. I'd like you to retract it publicly. I'd like you to restore my good name. Instead, he went to the city attorney and said, you have to represent me against her because I was a city employee at the time, and he never responded. But I thought it would have been the right thing to do. I also gave that information to the Columbian because the newspaper has repeatedly put stories in about the quiet zone, about my neighbors suing me, and they never show this other side that I've been harassed. They only show that that I've been sued, or when I was arrested for stalking.
Negative press as much as...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they just do the negative side of it. They don't indicate that I was found not guilty of anything. Mm-hmm. I've been acquitted of any charges, mm-hmm. but I had to go through all of that. And so, yeah, the negative press, but the idea, if you think about it, if you get targeted by powerful people who are unscrupulous, people in your city government, they can come after you and cite you for all kinds of things that make no sense, and that's the part that's the most frightening, when it doesn't make sense.
And they're using taxpayer dollars to do that, and mm-hmm. you're having to defend yourself with mm-hmm. your own money.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
I would expect that some people would just say, I can't do this. I don't
the
have
average
the time,
person
I don't have the
can't
resources.
Do it.
And
yeah.
they, so if did they ask you to just accept their charges and confess to something, and what did they want you to do?
I think they wanted me in prison. Either they wanted to get rid of my business, that didn't work. They arrested me for assaulting my neighbor when she bit me. And I think they were hoping that somehow this would get rid of me.
One possible resolution to this is that the city could have said, this is going to cost us so much to do this. And the neighbors could have said, we'd like to be able to have our property values increased because we don't like the noise in
right.
this area. And so in order to do that, we'd like to offer you to buy out your home
right.
here. And you can find another home someplace else, and And that would, everybody could potentially win if you were willing to mm-hmm. do that. Did anybody make such an offer of any
kind? No, but I did.
When you offered to sell?
I did. I offered to sell my house. I also, I asked them what they wanted. I didn't know what they wanted until 2009, till it started coming
right.
out. So I did ask my attorney, I said, would you offer them, do they want to buy my house? I've offered to sell my house a number of times. And in fact, when they first sued me in 2004, when they first sued me, about 3 months after the lawsuit, I said, I'll just sell my house. So I put my house up for sale.
So the city did not, or nobody offered to...
No. Mm-mm. Nobody came to me and said, we want a quiet zone. There's a bit of a pickle because you've got a business here. Can you work with this? Nobody asked me to work with them at all. They just attacked. And I think they just must have thought that it would be easier to target her and get rid of her than to ask for her cooperation. But when I did put my house up for sale, they wouldn't let me sell it. My neighbors called realtors and said, she's crazy, you don't want to sell this house. Mm-hmm. Two of my neighbors came into my driveway, spoke to my realtor and said, she's dangerous, crazy, something like that. You can't sell her house.
Is that just being vindictive? They're trying to punish you? Or they didn't want somebody, they'd rather have the house demolished than just...
Maybe. Because even if somebody lived there, we'd still have that dangerous private crossing.
But you said there's several other homes that share mm-hmm. that same crossing, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Do they have the same, why haven't then they been harassed the same way?
Well, but they don't have a home occupation there. They weren't harassed over that. They were harassing me because of that easement to the river. They got involved in the bigger picture of the quiet zone. It was a kind of two different forces coming together,
mm-hmm.
right? And they were eventually found guilty of harassment for doing that. I had to file motions and to get them to stop interfering with my realtors, and so they were told, because they would come out and ask people, what are you doing here? You're trespassing, when my realtor would try to show the property. So 2 years after I listed my house for sale, I finally got a protection order to keep them from doing that. But by then, I'd had no realtor wanted to come and show my property. It was too much, you know. They said, why would anybody want to live down there in that snake pit? Huh. Right?
Kathy, this is really so extreme.
It's bizarre.
It's hard to believe.
It just got out of control. Yeah. And I think it's because influential people had the ear of City Hall and were allowed to go do it. I have notes. I have the legal file of a very influential person where he's clearly noting, need to talk to Richard Landis, need to talk to Mayor Leavitt, need to talk to the city engineer. Apparently they were looking at how to, and they have my name there in their notes, how do we stop her? How do we get what we want?
And it all started from somebody just trying to go about their business,
right.
literally and figuratively.
You know, it's true. You know,
make a living for herself.
Also, I was going to tell you that because part of my practice is consulting with family businesses, family firms. I'm not a business consultant, but I'm a psychologist talking about the blend of family mm-hmm. and business mm-hmm. coming together. And as a result of the initial wave of attacks, I went to some of my clients who are business owners and I said, would you be willing to write letters for me to indicate that, you know, that it's been helpful and that my home-based business is not a threat to the community mm-hmm. and I'm really an asset because it's another business and mm-hmm. another employee, mm-hmm. you know. And so I had a number of business mm-hmm. owners in the community write letters.
So people did rally. Mm-hmm. Did you not have one neighbor that would come to your rescue that would speak on your behalf?
I had neighbors that would speak on my behalf. They just weren't influential.
Oh, just regular neighbors.
They were just regular neighbors who just didn't understand what was going on either. And I had a number mm-hmm. of clients, like I said, mm-hmm. business owners who wrote letters and said, we don't understand what's going on here. There shouldn't be a problem.
Up to the point mm-hmm. where you filed your suit, when did you file your suit?
2008? I think it was 2008.
Yeah.
You still did, the city at that point could still try to resolve this and say, this has really gotten way out of hand. Some things went wrong here, and there could be a city council member, could have been the ombudsman,
right,
to your advocate there to try to bring sanity to this. They could have. Was,
yes,
there, did you find any friend at all?
I did, actually. I contacted, I did contact Larry Smith again, and, you know, I was ignored. I contacted Tim Levitt, and he said he can't help me. I contacted Pat Campbell, and Pat Campbell did respond.
Larry Smith did not. Tim Levitt did not.
Right.
Pat Campbell responded.
And he said he wanted to meet somebody who was gutsy enough to fight for her rights. And he came out and he saw the situation and he said, well, this has got to be fixed. And that was prior to my discovering the letter, the Jim Jacks letter. When I found it, I sent that to him too and I said, this is wrong. And he demanded proof from the city attorney's office of the where they got the evidence to write this letter, and they ignored him. But he has been helpful in trying to at least get the city council to listen, but nobody listens. And the mayor has told me that he can't speak with me, that the city attorney has told him that he's not allowed to speak to me because I'm suing the city. And I keep pointing out to the mayor that he's my elected representative. I am not suing him, I'm suing the city government. I'm not suing Mayor Levitt. And he keeps saying, I'm sorry, the city attorney, who I am suing, tells him he can't speak with me. So I think that's wrong. I think my elected officials should represent me.
We have a dysfunction here to a degree that I think it's hard to believe.
It's bizarre, and I don't believe I'm the only one. I think that my story is bizarre, but I can't believe that other people haven't been targeted who didn't know how to fight for their rights or couldn't borrow on their house to pay their legal fees. I've been able to do that so far, you know, but this is wrong. And I have heard some stories about other people who get targeted because they just happen to be in the way of somebody who wants something.
Well, in all fairness, we don't want to paint our city as being just horrible thing. Hopefully this is an exception. But this is a glaring exception. This is a big problem for you. This is something that has hugely impacted you. What can we do if the...
Well, I do want to tell you one more thing. Before I found the letter saying what a terrible, crazy, dangerous person I am, before I found that letter, the city, I had sued the city already. When I discovered the letter, my attorney approached the city attorney's office and said, this letter is a bald-faced lie. This may explain why some city employees, not all are bad, but why some city employees thought they couldn't listen to me. I mean, if you thought that she was a liar and a danger to the community, you might not believe anything that I had to say, right? So he went to the city attorney, and she's the person who's representing the case said that they didn't care. It wasn't relevant to them. It didn't matter if it wasn't the truth. They weren't going to do anything about it. That's wrong. And I understand that lawyers have to protect their clients' rights, the city of Vancouver's rights, but what about mine? They've been trampled on for years now. My kids had to grow up being afraid that they had to ride the school bus with my neighbors' kids, right? That was frightening for them. They were worried. One of my daughters refused to go down to the river anymore for fear. Well, both of them actually don't go down there anymore. But one, I have an older daughter who has autism, and she was afraid to go down there because she was afraid she would be, you know, chased and scared. Mm-hmm. So I just think, you know, it's like when it's wrong, and this is so glaringly wrong, it seems like the mayor ought to step up to the plate and say, I'm going to take care of this. Or somebody should.
Somebody should. When the representatives
don't. And I shouldn't have to sue.
True.
To get it done.
True. But if they're using the force of law, they're using the city authority to basically target you, your only response up to this point, at this point, is you have to defend yourself. You have to be able to clear your name. You have to be exonerated. You've been exonerated a number of times because they've had multiple cases. Each one of them come out. It's clear. So hopefully, but we're telling the story so that the community can know what can happen when private property rights get trampled, when city representatives don't fulfill their role, when the city advocate or the advocate, the community, the citizen advocate, right, the ombudsman, abuses his power or takes the wrong side of things, when things, it just escalates out of control. So as citizens, if we're, now that we're aware of this, and the reason I became aware of it is because this became a national news, mm-hmm, the U.S. Observer, was it?
Right, U.S. Observer
we'll,
story.
We'll link to that on this story, on a text as part of this story, so that people can see, read about this. But what do we do as neighbors? What do we, how can we support you, Kathy? Just, it's not that we're not saying, well, we want to, this is taking a side of, against those neighbors that want quiet area by the trains.
I'd love like to have that. A quiet zone. I just want it to be safe.
Yeah.
So, I don't.
So
I'd
there
love
is
that.
A solution to this. They could put the railroad crossing, right, the standard railroad crossing there, and that way you're safe, it's quiet, and your reputation ought to be restored.
I don't know if that can ever happen. You know, once gossip gets out, I think people will just, if they hear my name and they've had any association with this, they'll still probably say those kind of things. But yeah, I think the neighbors could, I think they should contact City Hall. I think they should say this is outrageous what's happened. I think they should go to the Columbian. The Columbian newspaper has written not one word of my side of the story.
So they can write a letter to the editor.
They
maybe
could.
Maybe
somebody
would
finally print it. I doubt it. When they were doing the Jim Jacks resignation story, they said, does anybody have any information? I contacted them. I said, well, I have some. I know what Mr. Jacks was involved in terms of ruining my life, and that he's currently asked the city for protection. And as you know, the Columbian, editor of the Columbian wrote a story that there was no paper trail. There was no other information available about Mr. Jacks. Nothing. So I'd like the newspaper to maybe come clean with why they're withholding this information.
That's part of turning on the lights here, getting the story
turning
out in the
lights
open
on,
so that people can come clean. Certainly there are huge mistakes that were made. There, mm-hmm, are rights that were violated. There are things that never should have happened. Apologies are in order from those individuals that regardless of their what they're trying to accomplish, the process you go through, you can never, mm-hmm, trample on people's private property rights, regardless of how what you want
or
to.
Or their civil rights.
Civil rights.
The
right?
Civil rights are the most important, well, not the, mm-hmm, most important, but it's another important thing.
It's foundational.
Yeah. Right. I mean, I ought to be able to live in my home, be safe in my home. Sure. I have a deed to my property that you can't just take that away from me. Mm-hmm. You can't just lie to powerful people to try to destroy me, and I'm supposed to sit quietly and let that happen. Mm-hmm. You know, but how many people can do that? You know, if you can't, well, I don't trust anybody in our city government right now, because there are a few people that were helpful to me. There were a few people, but the second time I went back for help, they said, I'm sorry, I can't help you.
Okay, and let me do this, because right now you're here, you're able to present your side of the story, which sounds to me like so bizarre. But I would also extend to anyone who's listening to this story, anybody who's exposed to this, if you have something to offer then that will help to shed light on this, then speak the truth. Because we need to be able to make sure we're not afraid that the truth knows no fear of exposure, right?
Right.
We want the truth to be out.
It'd be fine with
whatever
me.
Whatever it is.
My neighbors wanted to come on your program or, you know, put in a letter to the editor that shows another side of this story. They're more than welcome to. I have, a dozen banker boxes worth of documents proving, mm-hmm, what I've just told you today. Mm-hmm. I'm not making this stuff up.
Yeah.
So, but if there's another side to this, I'd love to hear it.
Yeah. And because your credibility has been attacked,
right,
one of the reasons why that, Michelle, I'm glad that you're here. You're a very balanced person here. You know this person very well.
Mm-hmm.
She's sane.
Yes.
She's balanced. And she has a right to operate her business out of her home. She has a license to do that.
Yes. One of the things I should tell you, though, is I'm amazed that she's still with me.
Hmm.
Because it's frightening. It was very frightening to she didn't know if the police were going to come and arrest her, too. They came to my doorstep more than once. code enforcement more than once, and she'd have to answer those calls. And she said, I'm just amazed that she's got the courage to stick with me, because my previous secretary fled when code enforcement called her at home and threatened her if she reported to work.
If something happens threatening in your situation now, if you can you call the police and they'll respond to you and protect you like any other citizen?
No, the police have told me, I've been told by a number of police officers, Sergeant Knott was the first one to tell me that if I dared to call the police and ask for help, that they would arrest me for false reporting. So they had already gotten the word that from this Jack's report that they couldn't trust me. Now what they do is they will file a if I call about anything, they file, like my neighbor shot a rifle at me last summer.
I think it was a couple years ago.
Yeah. And I reported that. They did write an incident report. They do something called an incident report that I made a call, but they did nothing about it. And you would think that aiming a rifle at somebody would be something that you would thoroughly investigate.
You'd at least get a visit from a police officer.
Right. He never talked to me. He never talked to me. He wrote up the incident report. He went and talked to my neighbor, who said that I mistook a shovel for a rifle.
So I respect our police force, and it's not like the officers are out to get you or anything like that, but they've been instructed, and they're following policy.
They are.
That is being dictated to them. Say, here's our policy. And it sounds like you don't have the same kind of protection, the same kind of safety as other citizens, because the city has made you a target.
Well, here's another safety problem I have, is fire. I contacted the fire department back in 2005, I think it was, and said, could you please tell me how safe my neighborhood is with now that my neighbors are blocking the road with cars? The Campbells were blocking the road at one end, the other neighbors were blocking at the other end. I said, if cars are there with this 1908 train crossing, what's my safety problem down there? They did write a report. I never got it. Instead, it went to Richard Landis and the city attorney, and the report says that they can't get fire safety equipment to my house fast enough that I would have to be concerned about protecting myself privately from any fire damage. So they never gave me that report. I found it when I sued, and I got the documents. And I said, why would you keep this from me? Why wouldn't you tell me that I'm in danger? And why would you allow the neighbors to block the road so that a fire engine couldn't get down there? And they don't answer any of these questions. So I do have respect for people who put their lives on the line, like our police officers and our firefighters. And I think they are following orders. But whose orders? The mayor, the city manager, the city attorney. And those people are not telling them the truth.
So this is an opportunity for our city. Now the lights are turned on. We don't know how many people will hear the story or how many people already read that story. This is the opportunity for our city to make something right.
I think so.
To come forward and say, we're so sorry. We need for them to go on record and say, this never should have happened. And just to come to your defense. This is an opportunity. When things go wrong, it's really the reaction or the response to that that defines the character. In this case, we still have opportunity for our city to make this right.
Oh, and it's not like I'm just an angel. I've never made mistakes in my life. That's the whole thing. It's like that's what life's about, you know. You're going through life and you bumble here and there, you know, and sometimes you do big
Welcome
bumbles.
To the club.
Big bumbles. And yeah, it's exactly that. You say, okay, I need to clean this up. I made a terrible mistake. I harmed somebody else. I need to clean this up. So far, our city government is saying, we don't care. You can carry on by yourself regardless, which I will. I will take care of myself. But it's just wrong. It's not fair, and it's damaged my family permanently. Permanently damaged my children, I think. Maybe they'll get better, I don't know.
Naylene, I haven't given you much chance to ask some questions.
I love bringing things down to our real world. How does it relate to me in my backyard? And so I just want to comment on if those people that make laws and enforce laws have moms, dads, wives, husbands, children in their own lives that have been affected by something like this? What kind of emotions would that evoke in them? I think as citizens, we all need to think that way when we're encountering everybody, whether it be lawmakers or law enforcers. How would this affect me if it were my sister or, my own relative? And that's what evokes an emotion for action, I believe, personally, is if I had to stand in your shoes and fear.
I can tell you what it was like when my 15-year-old daughter came running to me saying, Mom, you know, Dawn and Melanie are chasing me and scaring me, and I don't, you know, help me. So I said, you see right here, and I went down to find out what was going on. I called the police when those two neighbors were chasing my daughter. One grabbed one girl, and the other grabbed the other girl's hoodie, and were telling them, screaming at them, telling them that they shouldn't be using the easement to the river, which by then I'd already had a court order. But I called the police, and because that was my daughter and her girlfriend, and I was frightened for her, and I was frightened for me, and I was outraged that they would still violate a court order that I had for my protection. Mm-hmm. I called the police and I said, I have protection. You need to do something. The police officer investigated, and he said, they have the right to chase your children off the property.
Even though it's public property?
It's a private easement. This part's the private to the river. But it doesn't matter. I had a court order, and I said, well, I can show you my court order, that they are supposed to stop this harassment. Mm-hmm. So it was frightening to me. I think I have post-traumatic stress disorder. Mm-hmm. I get upset at the sight every day when I drive home, when I see my neighbor's cars there, still blocking the road, by the way, even though they were court ordered not to. Mm-hmm. I still get scared. Mm-hmm. And even though I do respect people who put their lives on the line in terms of our firefighters and our police officers, when I see a police car, I'm frightened. I'm worried that they're going to come after me because they came after me time and time again, and then they never helped me when my child was frightened. Mm-hmm. And she was. They were out of breath. They were scared to death.
Fear motivates in ways we wouldn't realize until we've experienced that. Mm-hmm. We go into this almost different human level where we're protecting or getting rid of whatever is the cause
and
of
I think
fear.
Michelle has PTSD too, because she said she used to drive down to work and wonder if my house was going to be still standing there or if I was going to be arrested over the weekend, and she'd have to visit me at the county jail.
The emotional brain power that takes, the emotional time investment of that. Can you imagine having to manage your emotions?
I think it would drain you.
Very draining.
And depress you.
Yeah. But
it's like the world's against you.
One thing that helps Michelle and I is we do believe that there is a greater force taking care of all of this. And I think that's probably why I'm even on this mm-hmm. interview. I keep believing that this isn't happening for no reason.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I don't understand why it's happening to me, but I still believe it must be happening mm-hmm. for some reason, because maybe it's to help shake up City Hall. Maybe it's to help somebody else who's sitting there having a neighbor harassment thing going on, and they didn't know they could do something about it.
Right. Whatever their life experience is at the moment, the takeaway from what we're talking about, I wrote this down, that there's a social takeaway, in my opinion, is that not everything is as it appears. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm going to personalize this, because I'm mentally and emotionally and scholastically lazy, I'm just going to go ahead and go with what I see, and that must be truth, and I'll just go ahead and react and follow, just kind of follow suit like everybody around me. I would challenge myself in this conversation, and perhaps anybody else that wants to be challenged, when we observe things, to not take them at face value, but to invest the time to think, could there be something else involved in this? Could there be something else that I'm missing that will tell me, that will give me more facts if I were to broaden and open mm-hmm. my investment in this?
I think you're absolutely right. That's the thing that's been so stunning, is that people would travel with this gossip that I'm a dangerous, crazy sociopath, even when there's plenty of evidence that shows that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing that people will travel with gossip. And for example, the people that posted this wanted poster at Steamboat Landing, I still have never met them. We've never met face to face.
To touch on gossip for a minute, gossip is one of those things that we have two responsibilities. One, we have a responsibility not to share it, not
right.
to speak it.
Right.
But we also have a responsibility not to listen to it. So mm-hmm. if someone brings a negative report about someone else and they haven't talked to that as someone else, then we have a responsibility to say, I shouldn't be listening to this, and you shouldn't be sharing this with me. I'm not the appropriate person to say this.
I agree.
So please don't tell me that. And that checking will, that stopping, will we're doing a service to ourselves, to the person that's being talked about, and we're correcting the person that's spreading that, because it's a form mm-hmm. of poison.
Mm-hmm.
It divides people, it brings division, it breaks relationships, it distorts reality. It's just not the right path. So gossip is one of those things mm-hmm. that could do so much damage. And what you're speaking of is transparency.
Yes.
If we can be honest and transparent and forthright and truthful and not have this hidden selfish motive that would drive our behavior into most of these. When you start going down that road, it seems like it's an endless spiral. It becomes mm-hmm. to the point where it is so obvious and so bizarre that you wonder, how did I ever take those little steps to finally get you to that, to mm-hmm. the point where we are now?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This is something that is, I would be very surprised to hear if there is something that helped make this make sense, because it doesn't sound like it really makes sense. One way that people can...
I think it is the gossip. I think you're absolutely right. It just takes on a life of its own.
Mm-hmm. It's a form
and starts,
of poison.
Yeah. So it's not like one thing is the reason behind why I had suffered all of this.
Yes.
It's because people started spreading the word
yeah.
and not checking it out. And it's a terrible thing to do
mm-hmm.
to a person.
That's
and
right.
that's why I'm saying I don't think anybody's ever going... I don't think I will ever be exonerated in that, you know, that gossip totally cleared away, because it's gone on for too many years.
It not only is this is the city, the representatives there, those people that have been charged with their authority to do good things with the authority,
right,
to protect private property rights is one of the most fundamental roles of,
right.
of government, but we also have many other people. We have neighbors, and perhaps some of those neighbors can hear this story and hear from your point of view, and maybe they've never listened to you. They've only heard what other people have said, and they've been party to this, and they don't realize it.
Right.
And they can come forward and they can say, Kathy, I never realized. I am so sorry.
It'd mean a lot.
That would be helpful. One
mm-hmm.
way they can do that, they can write letters to the editor. They can write to you. Hopefully, you'll probably get some hate mail from those people that are still on doing this stuff.
Mail.
But hopefully you can get some letters and some cards and some people that would post comments on the story on Coop.com that would help you to realize they didn't realize what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
And some apologies and some support to rally behind you and say, this never should have happened,
mm-hmm.
and I had a part of this, and I am so sorry. And I will do what I can to help you. That to enroll their help would be a real step in the right direction. There needs to be some healing here.
There needs to be healing.
Healing doesn't happen unless people come forward and realize they got poison and they were part of it and apologize.
Mm-hmm. I
agree. You know about healing.
I do, I do. I know about healing, and I would love that. I would love even my immediate neighbors. If we could get together with a mediator or somebody and talk this through
mm-hmm.
instead of the continued spitefulness that's going on,
yeah.
There's no, that anger, that is poison, and I think they're going to get sick
mm-hmm.
operating that way. But yeah, I would love to see that.
When misunderstandings happen, they can lead to malice, they can lead to so many different things, and it builds because of this gossip just feeds on itself, and then you got this in their mind, whoever is part of that, they got this picture of who you are,
right,
and what your motives are, and how right. evil they paint this diabolical character that you are, and they've never talked with you.
Right.
They've never listened to you. They never heard your story. And you're one example of how things can get out of control when we each participate in repeating a story and say, yeah, have you heard this? And it's this devil's food of yuck that we shouldn't do to each other. We need to uphold each other and protect each other.
We do.
Cover each other's backs. Again,
That's what
life is
does.
All about relationships. I'm glad you have Michelle. She's sticking with you.
Yeah.
She helps to bring
she has
you
my back.
Some support and comfort. Good. And Michelle, I've known you and your husband for many, many years.
Mm-hmm.
You're highly respected in my eyes.
You're
not just, you haven't found another crazy to join you or something.
No.
This is a very...
She does a lot in the community. Michelle does, makes a major contribution in the community. She and her husband run a divorce recovery program.
Yes.
And in fact, they meet at US Digital.
Mm-hmm.
you volunteer your time to help
yes.
other people in a faith-based ministry.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And you care about people. And so this must really go against your grain to see such this whole thing happen. And I'm glad that you were there for Kathy to give her that support.
Sometimes she was most of the time she was my only support. Because even though I did have people that wanted to be helpful, they were afraid.
Mm-hmm.
This is another thing you need to understand is I've had a lot of people be terrified to come to my defense when it got this out of control because they were afraid they would be arrested.
Mm-hmm.
They would be targeted next. And that's again how an oppressive government can control people is to frighten them to death.
Mm-hmm.
And there are women and there are men. Us, just generally speaking, us men normally have a role of protector,
mm-hmm.
of safeguard. And one of the, I would appeal to the men that are out there. Hey guys, step up to the plate. Show some leadership. Defend this neighbor. Defend this woman.
Mm-hmm.
And don't be afraid about the circumstances of what's going to happen to me. Us guys, we like to. Yeah, we're wired that way.
Yeah, the warriors.
And so this, yeah, we're. So we need some leadership here. We need neighbors to speak up and be courageous about this and do what's right and say what's right, and show some guts. Do the right thing.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's the fruit of the seed of wanting truth and mm-hmm. perceiving people correctly and the desire to not gossip and spread lies. That becomes the actual tangible evidence of that heart.
Mm-hmm.
If we as citizens had that heart in and of ourselves, the people that we touch and the influence that we have could be so great.
It could be huge.
Yeah, I mean, and it starts with us. It really isn't like conquering the world and I'm gonna, you know, and it really starts with the right thinking.
Mm-hmm.
How am I gonna think right about myself and what I have in front of me?
What you think, what you say, and what you listen to has so much to do. And here we can build each other up, we can stand by each other. So know that. Kathy, you have a friend here.
I appreciate this. Thank you. I do. Ryan, I've got a new friend.
I don't care what the city says or what the city does.
Apparently.
I'm not afraid of those guys. I'm already a target. I don't care. You do what's right.
Yeah.
And it's an opportunity. If there's going to be heroes out there, hey, step up to the plate. Here we got a damsel in distress. Hey, guys.
I still am in distress. I mean, the city of Vancouver has said we're not going to stop this. It's not over.
The battle's still waging.
They are still hunkering down and saying, we're going to fight you on this, mm-hmm. when they should say we were wrong, apologize, and pay my legal fees.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's costing me a fortune.
It would.
Mm-hmm.
It would.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. I've got two new friends.
Yes.
Yes.
Definitely.
And hopefully you have a number of friends in the community after they hear your story.
Yeah, and I do. I have people out there now and that do care and don't, and they are trying to do what they can to make this mm-hmm. better.
I also think it bears repeating what you had said earlier, that we are open to discussing every aspect of this mm-hmm. issue. And the friends that we've made here today are not to the exclusion of other people that
That's
may
right.
have
That's right.
an opinion or mm-hmm. thoughts that differ from mm-hmm. our thoughts. Mm-hmm. Can you repeat that truth? I don't know how to repeat it as eloquently as you did, but truth knows
no
is
fear
not
of exposure.
Right. I think it bears repeating that. Mm-hmm. And there's no agenda. The only agenda is truth. I think that is very important.
That's right. And we've named a couple of names here. Jim Jacks, Scott Campbell. You've named a
Josephine
several.
Townsend, Richard Landis. Mm-hmm. Sure. Brian yeah. Carlson.
And I would invite, if they have a side of this story that hasn't been heard and somehow we've got even maybe you misunderstand or something, mm-hmm. The door is open. I'd be happy mm-hmm. to have an interview with them. Because what a proverb says that when one person tells their side of the story, it's like you're all convinced, and then you hear the other side and go, oh, there are two right. sides to the story. Mm-hmm. So is mm-hmm. if there is something that we're leaving out here, hey, let's get the truth out there. There's an open invite for people to mm-hmm. come who are in a position to have the inside scoop from the other point of view here mm-hmm. and reveal that truth and make sure we got it right here. Mm-hmm. But Kathy, it sounds like you've already been through a number of court cases here. They've all been, you've been exonerated on mm-hmm. each one of those.
Every single mm-hmm. time. Yep. So it doesn't make any sense.
From what we know at this point, this is an abuse of power.
Right.
And this needs to be made right. And there needs to be some laundry that needs to kind of air out in the open here, come out clean. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if people will believe that I'm okay with that. I've approached all of these people that you named and said, talk to me. Mm-hmm. I've sent them emails. I sent Scott Campbell an email, and he said if I contacted him again, he would get a restraining order against me. So they don't believe. I think they are still traveling on this lie that I am not an honorable person, and I am.
And mm-hmm. hopefully they will realize that they're misinformed.
I hope so.
That they haven't got it straight from you. They
and I'm willing to
some other gossip source.
Accept that too, that they are misinformed, mm-hmm. that they didn't realize, they didn't mm-hmm. follow up on this
are
properly.
You willing, if they come to you and they say, I have been misinformed and I really have been part of this, and I never really knew what the straight scoop was, would you forgive them?
Of course I would, because that's what we're being asked to do.
So
absolutely.
You're not doing this to be vindictive. You no. want to be able to get your life back. And you would like healing all the way around, because right. it's not just the in this case, the victim, which is you in this case, it's not just you that has suffered, but it's those people that share the poison that makes mm-hmm. their life miserable
true.
Too. There's guilt that comes with
I
that.
I feel bad about that. I actually feel bad that if I hadn't gotten involved in it at all, I mean, the positive part for me is that they pick somebody who's got stamina, and I do. Mm. But the negative part is that I haven't been able to reach people to stop them from going down this path, because it is poisonous. I just think how many people believe this stuff and have ruined their lives or their week or their day by believing it and gossiping to the next person and
yeah.
gossiping to the,
mm-hmm.
it's like, I don't know, I mean, well, anyway.
There's a misery that comes with that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. there is.
And everybody pays the price with gossip.
Everybody does. You know, every time I would come out of the court and I would win, I would hang in there, a week-long trial, 3 days of trial, whatever it was, and I'd get out on the courthouse steps, say goodbye to my lawyer, and then start crying. Because even though I won in court, there's no forgiveness, there's no healing. I just won the legal principle.
Yeah.
But I still, it's sad.
Yeah.
It's sad. I still live next door to these people who despise me because I protected my rights.
And you're telling your story in a very rational, reasonable way, but you have emotions and you have feelings, and mm-hmm. this cuts deep to your heart. So you've cried over this.
Oh, yeah.
And this is something that is, it's, we're not just talking about civil rights and property rights. We're talking about life here. Mm-hmm. You're talking about your family. Mm-hmm. This is an opportunity for people to show they care.
And I think what you were saying about people taking it personal, if you think about what would happen to you or your loved ones if they went through something like this. A lot of people see that I fought for my rights, but they don't recognize how it hurts. Mm-hmm. And I won't ever be the same. My children won't ever be the same. They won't. They're afraid. They're afraid.
It's a human level.
Right.
We're all humans. We mm-hmm. may hold way different statures and way different positions, but we're all human, and
right.
we all have the same emotional capacity.
Right.
And we all have a responsibility to care for each other to the degree that we can. Mm-hmm. Right. Anything else to share?
Well, we could go on and on, but this has been very helpful.
Really,
I appreciate this.
You've brought a number of materials here. There's a whole lot more behind this story, so we'll include that in the written portion, and we'll include links and whatever we can so people will understand more about the background of this. It's mm-hmm. hard to tell this story, even, and we've gone long on this interview, but even that, there's so much more to this story that... U.S. Observer.
Yes.
They check out extreme cases.
Right.
And they very carefully filter and make sure they got the straight scoop, that they're not being painting us something and find out they'd be surprised that they were wrong or something. And when I read that article, it was horrendous.
You couldn't believe it.
I couldn't believe it.
Right.
So I had to contact you and find out.
And that's only part of the story.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
more has come out today, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So hopefully the book is not finished yet. There are chapters yet to come.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully the tide will turn so that you mm-hmm. have support, you have friendship, you have
the
correction that mm-hmm. when the city makes mistakes, or should I say, it's one of the mistakes, when the city does something malicious, when they do things wrong, the correction can happen, mm-hmm. it can become a better place, the processes in place can be, we can learn from those errors,
mm-hmm.
we can learn from that experience to make things better. Hopefully we will. This is an opportunity. So I encourage everybody, step up to the plate, let's
do what's
right.
I'll keep you posted.
Here. Okay, right. Thank you. And you might watch the comments and see if people send some comments. You can reply mm-hmm. back and
yeah, I'm happy to. Yeah.
Okay, great. Right.
Thank you very much.
Thus begins a new chapter.
Thank you.
Yes, hopefully a new chapter of community rallying friendship.
I hope so.
All right. Thank you, Kathy. Thank
You're
you,
welcome.
Michelle.
Thank you.
Okay, that wraps it for Cloud County Today.